I just want to make a correction. It's Nandini Nair. Anyway, going ahead, I'm very privileged and honored to be in conversation with Professor Teltubde because of his body of work and how relevant he is to today's politics. I'm just going to go straight into the questions because we've kind of discussed this a little bit and we have a format in mind. So the name of this session is Annihilation of Caste, and of course it's a term that we hear very often, but how do you interpret it?
Well, annihilation of caste is known to people, I suppose. The question comes, what do we annihilate? That is the thing. So caste actually have been changing. So if we want to annihilate something, that needs to exist. And that follows that if we want to annihilate caste, that means a contemporary caste, which is quite different from what Babasaheb Ambedkar struggled against. Okay? So many of you might be aware of his book, Annihilation of Caste, where he has systematically diagnosed entire historical evolution of Indian society and how the castes are formed, and he traced the roots in the Hindu Dharma Shastras. And he came logically to say that unless Hindu Dharma Shastras were dynamited, probably annihilation of caste is not possible. The main question before us is whether the caste remained the same. In my writings, I have been juggling with this question and have written that today's castes are something like a mix of cultural sediment of past and much of it as the constitutional caste, because the constitutional structure that we evolved in a post-colonial state actually support the caste. Castes are constitutional structure that might be for you, so let me make it explicit, something like election system. The castes are used for electoral system, and another thing is very much talked about is reservation. So basically, castes are sustained because of these kinds of things, and if we want to annihilate them, we'll have to annihilate them together. So the sediment of the past culture, which might be traced to Hindu Dharma Shastras, etc., but that is not very alive today. What we see around us is not really traceable to the Hindu Dharma Shastras. It's somewhere else. Culture not necessarily comes from the religion itself. So we'll have to think through this thing. The annihilation of caste would be something like dispelling the poison of prejudice, hatred for Dalits. And today's caste, contemporary castes, are mostly in relation to Dalits. So that needs to be kept in mind, because it's not a continuum of hierarchy that Ambedkar spoke about, the graded hierarchy, etc. But it is something like the Dalit constitutes the scaffolding for the caste structure. And generally, it needs to be identified in relation to that. So I would say that annihilation of caste to me would be something like dispelling all this poison, and additionally demolishing the structure which actually sustains it.
You mentioned reservations, and I know you have a slightly different point of view on it. So do you think reservations in a way perpetuates the system, or is it abetting?
I think that question cannot be discussed in a shorthand manner. So reservation, you know, there's a very controversial, the way I write in nuanced form probably is not understood. So let me not venture into that. In short, what happens is that reservation as such, because as regard the prejudice were concerned and the way it was instituted by the colonial state, entirely attributable to Babasaheb Ambedkar, was necessary and was perfect. But in post-colonial time, the way that got weaponized by our new rulers has been a very vicious.
Mentioned, you mentioned Ambedkar, so I will ask you, since we are going to be celebrating the 70th year of the Constitution soon, what does the Constitution mean to you personally?
I'm not as much enamored by a constitution because constitution holds the root. Actually, Constitution of India, the positive side of it is that it actually provides the moral fabric, but it lacks in its essential role to provide something like checks and balances in governance structure and accountability system in this thing. What we are actually experiencing, that without changing a comma or semicolon of the constitution, some people just have usurped and completely changed the structure to the fascist structure. So that needs to be rethought, because there are many things, and it's tactically probably I would support to save the constitution is a big kind of slogan, and that needs to be supported in the present juncture. But after we are past it, probably we may have to rethink this structure itself, because you see, if you look through how we constructed the post-colonial state, it has been basically a clone of colonial state. There is nothing different. You know, the constitution itself has been three-fourths of the India Act 1935, which was the last colonial structure that we had. Then entire governance structure we have adopted in toto. There has not been any change. Even IPC, that actually interface state with the common man, that remained the same. Even the draconian laws that we suffered from, they were inherited from the colonial system in toto. And thereafter we added, of course, hundreds of them, and we actually kept silent about it. So this is, at some point, we may have to problematize the constitution itself. And after this, after we finish with these monsters, we may have to rethink about the constitution.
When you say rethink the constitution, what do you mean?
We may have to rethink about the way the mischiefs were done about the secularism. This word did not exist, and it is vaguely defined in the constitution, and the byproduct of that is our communal kind of strife, which actually amplifies into what we suffer today. And same is the question about the caste. As I said just briefly, that the reservations were weaponized to preserve the caste. Okay, they were proliferated, that caste would be actually pervade all over, you know. So those things are needed, they need to be understood in nuanced manner. And so is the case with socialism also. Socialism, the kind of inequality that we have today, India is the most unequal society today. Many people do not understand, but India is, economically speaking, most unequal society today. And socially, of course, entire this thing, I keep on saying it, no rhetoric, because I'm not taking to rhetoric, that India was never as much casteized as it exists today. So that also needs to be thought through.
So a figure like Chandrasekhar Azad, who's been in the news of late, he's been, of course, he emerged out of jail holding the constitution, etc. But how do you see a figure like him?
It's very difficult to speak about individuals, but all right, Chandrasekhar Azad, there's a lot of promise, has got drive, enthusiasm and leadership quality that he can mobilize the youth around the issues. Only thing that he needs to do is to understand the social situation little bit carefully, because that is the missing point in the entire Dalit movement. Firstly, you have to understand what environment you are in, and then only you can fight the forces which dominate it.
So what would this environment be? Like, what are the things you would want him to notice which you think he might be missing?
What happens is that in the entire Dalit movement at a point actually reflect the continuum of as if this society was in the deep freezer and nothing has changed. everything has changed, you know, everything has changed. It's not a 1920 caste, it's not a 1920 forces, it's not a, and even if you take thereafter post-colonial times also, things have changed. It was not 60s that the emergency had happened, and thereafter, you know, in 1990, the new liberalism had come in, and there are and the Hindutva alongside. So things have not remained the same. The forces have changed, equations have changed, everything has changed. The world is not the same. So you cannot assume the world was a deep freezer and then articulate your struggle also in the same manner. That would be misfiring.
Do you think someone like Mayawati and her party have recognized that it's no longer in a deep freezer and that things have moved on?
Should we really talk about that? I think, you know, Mayawati's positive thing is that they grasp the grammar of power, and they succeeded to some extent, but she also realizes, but in course of time, now she has the money to survive with. And that is it. The Dalit movement would stay like that. You know, there are many such kind of Dalit leaders, and better not talk about them in any more detail.
Okay, then maybe we'll move on a bit to your own story. And I think in one of your forewords to one of your books, you also mentioned how you started fighting against oppression and for equality from school itself. And there's an interesting anecdote about you taking on the RSS in class 7 or 8. Could you tell the audience a bit about that?
Oh, you might be referring to the Republic of Caste kind of thing. I very reluctantly, I don't want to speak about myself, but this Anand, for reason, commercial reason, he wanted to write something about that, and then I told him a little brief. You know, this ran through, it was a kind of incident, there are series of incidents of this kind, but in our school, you know, it was an elite school in our area, and mostly dominated by Brahmin. So the Brahmin boys, the school uniform used to be something like a white shirt, blue pant, and Gandhi topi, white topi cap. But these people, you know, Brahmin students came with a black cap, the RSS typical cap, what Mohan Bhagwat wears. So that kind of cap, and it was normal. You know, nobody questioned, nobody problematized. So one thing that we came from village, and something like because of my scholastic kind of thing, I was made a monitor and things like that. So next year we got groomed into and understood the situation and thought we would. So I used to do painting, etc. So I earned lots of money to buy hundreds, I think 100, 200 blue caps. So there was no sense of these that they were RSS, or I did not know much about it, but only thing RSS was identified the Brahmin kind of group. And then we distributed caps to everyone, and suddenly one thing in prayer times, the half of the people were wearing blue caps. So that was apparent. Prayer, the interesting thing is the custodian of the discipline was a PT teacher who was a Dalit, Vaghamare. And he came, and then all the blue caps were retained, and something like he came to some, they scolded us, etc. And then he raised his hand to something to beat. And he was caught like this. So then he got terrified. Then I was, of course, they identified who was behind it, etc. And then I was taken to headmaster. Headmaster said, okay, rusticate me, doesn't matter. But we will not give up until these black caps go. He was Muslim. Very interesting combination. So he tried to anyway terrorize me initially, but then relented and said that they are very powerful people. All that kind of, why do you indulge? I will talk to them and we'll settle this, etc. So I said, okay, it might take 2-3 days. You start talking, but we'll not relent, we'll not remove the blue caps. And suddenly, after a couple of days, I think, I don't recall properly, but a couple of days, we had to do it again only once, and those black cap disappeared. That's the small episode. That's it.
So it did end with the black caps disappearing. So the black caps did disappear.
Yeah.
And I think in your dedication of Republic to Caste, it's a very beautiful dedication, and you write, "It's to my unlettered mother Anusuya, who epitomized the value of struggle, and to Puka and Puch, my well-educated daughters, who I hope internalize it." So can you tell us about this trajectory a bit from your...
Very personal. you see, I come from poorest of the poor family, and we had to struggle. It was a big family of 8 children, and my parents worked hard. And in that also, in a general household and village and Dalit household, in that, the way it matters. My mother's contribution, I thought, was maximum. So I dedicated it to her. And it's a contrast that my daughters never could sort of imagine also that. So we came through that. And what happens was, they lived as the South Bombay girls, one of the richest areas probably in India, right on the seashore. So that kind of stuff. It does not sort of mean the same. So I wish that they also realize the value of struggle and achieve excellence, because at some point in time, my mother has been inspiration and mother has been sort of controller also, that we have been what we are.
Thank you. I think also your personal story, like you mentioned, is so interesting, because you've sort of been at the top of a corporate job, and you have then given that up to be an academic and a full-time writer. And like you say, you have sort of sat in boardrooms, but you've also held aloft the red flag. So combining these different strands, how does that influence your outlook to the world?
I thought you would confine to Annihilation of Caste.
But this is all part of that, right?
All right. Yeah, no, because whatever this thing, I just started writing and this clicked something, like I became very, very casteist, like, you know, when one writes on a caste and discusses that thing, probably it means being casteist. Well, I have other side of it also. I've been a corporate person. I have come through very elite institutions, very unlike my background. That been very contradictions also. Everybody deals with certain amount of contradiction. In my case, probably it has been very stark and too intense. Like one side being something like a corporate head. I was literally CEO of a holding company. And other side, even being a CEO, I did not hesitate on a May Day to lead the procession with red flag. So that was my political conviction. And it's a acrobatics that I lived through and probably managed. I don't know. I don't want to look back. But the only lesson, or those who want to emulate this kind of track, I would say that be honest to yourself. It doesn't really matter, because it doesn't really matter that if you're a Marxist or something like or that kind, does not mean that tomorrow you are going to bring about the revolution. You know, the Engels, Marx's friend, was a textile mill owner, but he was a Marxist, you know, in that way, you know, if you call Marx as a Marxist kind. So Marx himself was a petty bourgeois, the very rich family he comes from, okay, and doesn't really mean. So all these things are a process, and you have to live through this contradiction. It did not really impinge in my life any time, that those contradictions, that in my corporate role, I did not have to give up really my political convictions. And I lived through. Whenever the problem came, I stood by my convictions and took a decision. Took a decision for the company. Okay, so I did not find any compromises as such.
What is it like to teach students today? So sort of going to a very different question. You, of course, are a cybernetics professor, but in your classes, what are the classes like? Just as a...
No, I don't teach cybernetics. My PhD has been on cybernetics, which very few people actually touched upon that subject. Been very mathematical and... but it interested me a lot because the cybernetics means something like looking at the anything in a systemic view, as Norbert Rimmer, you know, defined it. It was a science of control and communication in animate as well as inanimate world. So that way, so anything could be seen and it could be applied to the social problems, social systems, etc. So that way. So I do not precisely teach cybernetics per se, but it comes handy. I teach this big data analytics, again a frontier kind of subject in these days, in big thing. So such big things I've been dealing with small things like caste.
Okay, then we'll go back to caste. What is the nature of the Dalit struggle today?
Dalits have an arduous task, I suppose, because the resurgence of Hindutva is nothing but the Brahminism in a modern era. So it's very deadly combination. The fascism, I don't need to sort of repeat that kind of thing. Everybody knows that the present kind of junta that are in saddle, their ideal has been a fascism in Italy. So all those things are in public domain, so that could be read, but it's a very deadly combination. So it's not to be understood that they would really bring in Brahminism of that Manu or whosoever it is, but it's Brahminism in present era. So now that actually lent lots many strengths to the these forces, you know. So something like technology, something like modern state, something like modern management for that matter, all these kinds of tools now are at their disposal, and they lend so much strength to them. So the enemy's power as such, it becomes quite formidable. So that needs to be understood. The fascist grammar, then again you cannot forget about globalization, neoliberalism. That philosophy in India, if we look at the rise of Hindutva movement and the globalization movement right from 90 onward, probably it goes in conjunction, it goes parallel, and each reinforces the other. So that kind of thing has been happening. So these are the challenges with the Dalit movement. Now, Dalit movement will have to look at, as I said in the context of Chandrasekhar Azad, we'll have to really understand how we are situated. Because the same way kind of identitarian approach to Dalit, etc., is not going to work. Unless there is a broader unity of people who come against these kinds of forces, they would be very difficult to be defeated.
What are the particular challenges to the Dalit movement when it comes to Hindutva? Like what are the particular things they face, especially when in relation to Hindutva?
Dalit pick up one dimension, and it's very important that they do identify as a Brahminism, and they are deadly against. I mean, if any force is really in contradiction with the Hindutva, in that sense, would be Dalits. So that so there is no dispute about it. And they identify the dimension. Only thing, the methods of fighting it, etc., will have to be honed. What I see is that if you use the casteist idiom for sort of articulating your struggle or mobilizing masses, it wouldn't work, because needs to be understood that caste is unlike any other category. Caste only knows how to split. Caste, the essence of caste is basically hierarchy. It seeks hierarchy. And thereby actually goes on splitting like amoeba. So such kind of a thing cannot be used for bringing people together. So that limitation of caste needs to be sort of internalized, and many things would fall in line.
So how do we achieve solidarity? Like whether it is within the Dalit community or across the Dalit community with others?
Today it becomes too difficult, but if we approach it from the viewpoint that only people could come together on something like a class as an alternate to caste, you know, even within caste, even within among Dalits, there has been a classes formed. And class for me is not something like the economic category, something like a Brahminical sanitized economic category, I would say that way. Actually, every class has to be conceived with its existent impurities. It will never be puritanical class. Many people attribute it to Marx, etc., because that contradiction he referred to in relation to bourgeois proletariat, etc., etc. So that is misconstrued that he meant that thing. It is something like a conceptual terms, but when you comes to practice, they will always be mixed up with these impurities, and they needed to be fought through. And that viable fighting against these things would always be a class unity of people. The caste needs to be struggled against consciously, but within a class framework.
I guess this is something you've also written about in your columns, but the intermingling of class and caste in India today. Could you talk a bit about that? About class and caste and the intermingling of those two.
That's what I meant. If we look at the society today, you will not find something like a pure caste or pure class like that. These are intermingled because, as a matter of fact, they existed always. Even in 1920s, when the communist movement started or Babasaheb's movement started, they were like this. But today the entire world has come to somewhere that where this kind of the primitive kinds of identities got mixed up with the class, and they cannot be separated out. They're so much integral now. So we'll have to take them together.
Recently, you were in the news for various reasons, and I know the international media, for example, did an article on you, and they called you one of India's leading anti-Modi intellectuals. So a tag like that, do you see that as a burden? Do you see that as a responsibility? How does that influence your work, or you just don't bother about it?
I think before New York Times called me that, the Guardian had written something like one article wherein identified that one of the biggest critic of Modi government and all. I don't really relish that epithet. I do not have any quarrel with Modi as an individual. But any individual, if he is out to destroy my country, if he is out to spread poison in my people, if he is out to doom my economy, if he out to take away bread from my children, I would be against. I would be deadly against him.
So how do you see, I live in Delhi, and I guess in Delhi we've sort of seen the anti-CAA protests, etc., and across the country as well. How do you see the act, and how do you see the protests to it?
In this hopeless situation, probably this anti-CAA NRC movement, the ideal example could be the ladies in Shaheenbagh, gives me little hope. But Well, most of the times they sound very hopeless, and people do question me, you are sounding very pessimist, don't you see some hope, etc. So my counter question or an answer typically is that unless you realize the reality, you cannot be optimistic. I said once that the very fact that I am talking to you, that I have still a hope, okay, that you would understand, that you would come forward, that you would rise in protest. So this is the way. It's a way of understanding the reality around us and then be whatever it is. If you are just for the sake of being optimist, if you're optimist, I would say you are the biggest fool. Well, these things are the way the CA and NRC agitation against all odds are being carried out. This really gives hope. But the people dealing with that are quite dangerous. You know, they could crash, you know. And after all, people, how many times they can again come up? How do they endure? What wherewithal? They have a state power with them. So these factors need to be kept in mind, but there is no other alternative than carrying it on.
So Shaheen Bagh, for example, is a wonderful example of women coming out and of women sort of taking a claim to the street. And they're there simply because they think something is wrong and they want to do the right thing and they are there for justice's reason. It's often said that Dalit women are thrice oppressed because of gender, then of course because of their caste. Do you see Dalit women's assertion happening? Where do you see it happening and where do you think it might happen?
Yes, Dalit women are not any behind, because in Ambedkar's movement, although they were not given as much prominence, but they were important. So typically a Dalit woman actually faces something like a triple odds. She is oppressed by class, she is exploited by caste, and there is another gender exploitation which actually all women suffer from. So the three things, the triple kind of negatives that Dalit woman typically suffers from. The only thing in mathematically, when we deal with these kinds of things, the three legs are to be properly balanced. That time, this becomes a priority problem, you know. So what do you fight against? What do you fight against? So that needs to be properly discerned. Now, that extended to that, that kind of problem actually is faced by Dalit in general. So it's a matter of priority. Now, all these kinds of odds that we face, so which one we have to prioritize? So class, caste, gender. So Dalit women have to think through. Otherwise, what happens is that without this kind of awareness, you could be firing, you know, somewhere else, which is not as much important.
I think recently the Human Rights Watch sort of came out with this rather scathing report, and it said the Narendra Modi government has continued its widespread practice of harassing and sometimes prosecuting outspoken human rights defenders and journalists for criticizing government officials and policies. So you have personally experienced the backlash of that, of being a critic and of the government, and you've had your house raided, and you've had charges levied against you.
Arrested also.
And arrested, exactly. And I think you have written about, as you talk about, the humiliation of it and also just your astonishment at it. So could you talk to the audience a bit about that?
My lawyers advised me not to talk about. Everybody knows, probably it is in public domain, so this is going on. Only thing I would say that it is not that happened to us or XYZ people. It could happen to any one of you. any one of you, literally any one of you, don't be under any illusion that the kind of Bhima Koregaon were constructed, anything can happen to you. So that's it. They are targeting, you know, they don't want any human rights talk. They do not want any rational, logical things to be furthered. They want to de-rationalize. That is the fascist grammar. They want to de-rationalize, de-intellectualize, and so on and so forth. You can actually, if you want to understand today's India, probably you could very well read 20 of Italy of 1920s, 30s.
When you say de-rationalize, de-intellectualize, can you expand on that? What does that mean?
Rationality brings in men a threat to autocracy. And that they don't want. So intellectualism, etc., is a, you know, you orient to see what is the kind of, it brings in something like these are facts and these are kinds of things, but their dictum is totally different. You know, there would be, they would say that, okay, everything to be sacrificed with the imaginary nation. There should be a leader. All people should be following that dictum. So nation's prosperity would come through that. So these are the kinds of things, or our culture was like that, you know. There is no argument that remains. If you de-rationalize, then only what hangs around is what they say. And they say it forcefully. You cannot argue. The argument itself is a criminal act.
So seeing what's happening in institutes of higher learning, whether it's JNU or AMU or Jamia, do you think that's also, they're afraid of it because these are sort of bastions of thought and questioning? Or how do you interpret what's happened at these universities?
Of course, there is a dimension of that because JNU, for instance, questions them. JNU stood for something like a liberal atmosphere and those people, and they anyway can be labeled that, okay, left liberal, center of left liberalism, or the, going a step forward, something like urban Naxals, you know. So that kind of thing. So this is the same dimension, that's the same translation. And student community is a very dangerous community that they are very, very sensitive about. So they caught hold of the centers of the student movement or agitation, etc. And they wanted to curb it by itself so that other people get terrorized. They do not rise up, you know.
But why do they see students as such a threat? Why do they see students as such a threat? As such a threat? Why are they threatened by students? Why are they threatened by students? Why do they see students as a dangerous force?
Yeah, many changes, historical changes have been initiated by students. So if students stand against something like a regime, that's a dangerous thing. Students need to be controlled by anyone, you know, so that is very obvious.
We'll move to some audience questions and then maybe we can, what's the time? Does anyone have questions?
Respected sir, Baba Sahib Ambedkar actually wanted to annihilate caste from the Indian society. During the drafting of the constitution also, his biggest dream was to annihilate caste. But he miserably failed because other members were not at all supporting him. Even now, caste plays a major role in all the sectors, in all the facts. Whether My first question is whether you feel that instead of what is called abolishing untouchability under Article 17 of the Constitution, do you feel that whether caste can be abolished or annihilated from the Indian society? Second question is, in India, no political parties have been divided into urban and rural. But Naxals have been divided as urban and rural. You are also one of the victims in the Bhim Korago incident in 2018. Do you feel that such a division will affect in our fight against injustice? Third question is that, what is the, you, when Madam put a question to you about you, Chandrasekhar Azad, you told that, you said that atmosphere is not conducive. Whether in order to fight against justice, especially by the Dalits and tribals, whether any atmosphere is required, conducive atmosphere is required in India to fight against all these evils? Please answer one by one. Thank you, sir. First question is whether annihilation of caste is possible from the Indian society. Third one is about a question put by Madam on Chandrasekhar Azad. You said that this is not a good atmosphere like that. You answered whether any atmosphere is required for fighting against injustice, especially by leaders like Chandrasekhar Azad.
Okay.
Whether we people are afraid or leaders are afraid of the ruling class.
All right. Okay.
That's my questions.
Okay, one by one. Baba Sahib Ambedkar, everybody knows that he struggled entire life to annihilate caste. He was the first one who clearly came against caste, that these need to be annihilated. And before that, there were stray people, they lost in history, etc. But we do know, the knowledgeable people do know, that the similar kinds of things are said by others also. But Baba Sahib Ambedkar comes out as a prominent figure to say it clear cut that caste have to be annihilated. Well, so his entire struggle has been towards that, and whatever that he did, etc., etc., whether that cohort towards that goal or not, etc., needs to be examined now. But in the given situation, when the constitution was being drafted, you know, that's very, very dynamic, and Ambedkar's role in that needs to be again carefully seen. What were his compulsions? What he wanted to get into Constituent Assembly, etc., etc. Now, people have a notion that when constitution was drafted, it abolished caste. No, it was not abolished. Caste was not abolished. What was abolished was untouchability. Untouchability is aspect of a caste. Okay, that is not entire caste. It's just an aspect of caste. And untouchability was one which embarrassed all the upper caste Hindu reformers. There is none who did not speak against untouchability per se. So that was their craving. But did none again explicitly speak against caste? So that is also truth alongside. So Constituent Assembly Mahatma Gandhi ki jai outlawed untouchability, and people thought that caste were being outlawed. It did not happen. So caste, however, were preserved, as I said, by weaponizing reservations. Okay. Reservations in a colonial days was only meant for Dalits as an exceptional people. There was no dispute about Dalits being exceptional people, because howsoever they were meritorious, whatever that merit you need not bring in, but howsoever it is, the society was not there to give them a due. So there was something like a countervailing force of preservation that, okay, this needs to be done. There was not much of murmur against it. But in a post-colonial state, when the constitution was being written, it got diluted. Okay? They created another schedule per scheduled tribe. There's no way, no, don't misunderstand me, the tribal did not require this thing. But reservation is not a panacea. then they extended to the people whom they did not know even. Okay? And they said that educationally and socially backward, etc. That kind of thing now, everybody, there is no caste in India probably who does not actually claim to be socially and educationally backward. So this was the process of casteization. They wanted this because caste was proven kind of weapon which actually divided people very, very efficiently. And so is the case with the secularism. So is the case with everything, you know. So these kinds of intrigues were being played in the Constituent Assembly itself. Second question was... Second question was just a clue. What was the second question? Do you remember?
Urban nexus. Urban nexus.
Okay. Got it. All parties, they are not divided in urban-rural matter, but the Naxals are divided in urban and... Okay. There is nothing much to be read in that. That is the term because Naxalites were identified to be working in rural area and jungles, etc., etc. So they wanted to criminalize all people who are against them as urban Naxal. That is a simple thing. So that brings in a... that actually covers entire gamut of urban area. You know, you be in the university, you be a teacher, you be in a trade union movement or any movement for that matter, civil rights movement, etc. You speak against, you speak for the people's right, you speak against the government, the powers that be, and you could be labeled as urban Naxal. So that they created that label. Nothing much beyond. This is a very tactical thing. As regards Chandrasekhar Azad, I did not say that, what you said. I don't know. What I said is that many such people are emerging from among Dalits, and the youngsters have to come forward, and Chandrasekhar Azad probably exemplifies the process. What I wanted just to caution is that he needs to pay attention to and try to understand the reality in a specific way. Because what reflects is that castes were in a deep freezer, they are just like that, and they can be dealt with by repeating what Babasaheb Ambedkar did. That is no solution. That's the only question that I want to sort of extend.
Good afternoon, sir. So my question is a confluence of your thought on annihilation of caste and also the book that you have written, that Indian Communism, and the introduction to it. So my, it's not a doubt, it's an observation where in that book I saw that Marx was not unaware of what is happening in India, especially connected to caste. That's one point. And in India, where you find a confluence of Ambedkarite movement along with communism, which used to happen, and after a point of time, there was a departure. So how do you, what is your take on how the caste system should be addressed? Because there is a huge discussion and debate that communism doesn't address caste system. But I find that be it Ambedkarite movement or be it communist movement, there is a strong cadre system and a strong, you know, a managerial capacity where a certain issue could be addressed. So do you think that there should be a confluence between the caste struggles that we find today and communism, and I don't know how much annihilation of caste is possible, but at least to address the concept of caste.
Yeah. that's not quite true. Probably I have not written. I don't recall everything that I have written, but... my things are consistent, so on that basis I can say that I'm not written that Marx did not know what was happening in India. Certainly Marx did not know in details what was happening in India, and Marx and Marx's way of looking at the society wasn't on very macro terms. He did concern with micro details as regard the economics, etc. is concerned. You know, look at the mathematical workings of Marx, etc. You get amazed the way he taught himself and way he dealt with the minutest kinds of problem, economic formulation. So it's very amazing. So, and to his credit, probably one could say that if anybody has problematized caste first, prominent, there could be several people, I do not know, but the ones we know, it's Marx. Marx, while writing in New York Tribune, some people belittle it as a journalistic writings, etc., etc. But all said and done, he problematized it, something like the biggest impediment in India's progress. Okay, precedes Mahatma Phule also. Phule, the pioneer, the great. Okay, so, and that is not to bring, give some marks to create marks or something like that. It's not from that angle. Just a clarification. Second thing, I traced out in the introduction to India communism, like how this movement, my premise is that this movement needed to be together. Okay, they could have gone together and it happened. You know, Ambedkar was no Marxist. There's no issue about that. And the so-called Marxists, those who were Marxists, also were no Marxists. That is not so much known to people. They were also not Marxist. The kind of the Ambedkar as a non-Marxist actually extended hands. Examples I had given, two, three instances are there in Maharashtra history that Ambedkar extended hand and wanted to carry on. And to the credit of communists also, they also participated in a struggle. But somewhere down the line, then they started kind of diverging. Okay, so biggest one of the things that can be identified is electoral politics. That could be identified as the culprit, the foremost culprit. And thereafter, the entire thing the Ambedkar took a route of, because he was constantly kind of looking at the situation, which was the political situation rather, which is actually developing along the communal lines, etc. And he had to take that kind of stand to prove his existence, because there's an ILP, Indian Independent Labour Party period. Many scholars of Ambedkar agree on one point, that he actually tries to come very, very close to Marxism. Okay, Marxist system. And I rather problematize that Ambedkar still was not a Marxist. He was a heavily Fabian kind of manifestation, okay, which is not Marxism. Rather, it turns against Marxism. So that apart, these are the little bit, it cannot be dealt with superfluously. So that apart, and that's not our focus. So unfortunately, down that line, and there could be causes, that there are indications of that in that introduction, that they went on diverging to the extent, standing at this point in time, something like Dalits would treat Marxism as the biggest enemy. Marxists are the biggest enemy. They are on a Hindutva people's lap, but they would think that the communists cannot be touched with even barge pole. So this is the kind of thing. And howsoever the degenerate communist parties also try to woo now Dalits, they are also futile. They do not understand anything of caste. Okay, they do not understand any bit of Dalit dynamic. They just kind of extend their hand that, oh, this is the lot which is actually forsaken by everyone. Now they could be coming and voting for us. That is the only approach. So this is again not communism. Okay, this is an unfortunate development of this land. If these people had been together, India's history would have been totally different.
Good evening, sir. Yeah, so I know it's a bit optimistic to believe that we can annihilate caste, but what can be done to moderate the atrocities that are done purely on the basis of caste? I mean, I'm not talking about villages and all. Even in cities now, like most urban cities, these things happen. And recently, the lady died in Mumbai. And like a year ago, you were also detained illegally. So the law also does not seem to be working. So what can work? Also, a second question on a lighter note. Have you ever wish that Ambedkar was a better politician.
Yeah, atrocities are definitely a big problem, and rather I wrote a full-length book on that, tried in my own way explaining that, linking it to the political economy, etc., etc. The purpose was that people should not understand it just like happens through the prejudices. There is a political economy behind entire construction. And what I meant to start with by annihilation of caste, etc., is precisely that, that unless these structures which actually support these kinds of things are blasted off, these things will not be dealt with. So that is that. Atrocities have been galloping, you know, like in even the Sensex rises and comes down, etc. There's a fluctuation kind of thing, but atrocities reflect a trend, you know, upward trend. And today probably even Modi had now started, publishing the figures. We had an institution, NCRB, which actually collected the police data and published it regularly. Now the reports are not forthcoming and they change the format, etc. So it becomes, you have to be researcher, you know. The joke is like 14 was the last report, and if you read the 2014 and then 2016 they brought in figures, they do not tally. They are totally different, okay? Totally different, and they're still they're carrying on. So on atrocity that much. Second question. I don't know how better politician, but yeah, Ambedkar was everybody together, you know. You have to be that remarkable person. He tried doing, not that I do not spare anyone. So I've been very critical of Ambedkar, I've been very critical of Marx, I've been very critical. What I want to say is there is nothing, no man who comes as a perfect something like this thing. It's always everybody contributes something. That positive needs to be eulogized, should be upheld, and negative should be criticized, and we have to find our path forward, because they have provided their shoulder for us to stand on and look beyond, okay? For that, we are obligated to them, not otherwise.
Sir, you mentioned that untouchability, rather than a practice, is a practice of casteism. So if untouchability is removed, in post-millennial India, do you think casteism is more like a corporate-driven modernization based on the materialistic approaches, like a blue-collar job, a white-collar job, and all? And if that is the case, do you think how such a system can be taken off when India is moving more into a corporate power? And if this happens, if untouchability is not a practice of casteism, so does that contribute to Gandhi's saying that casteism is the genius of the Hindu system?
Gandhi said last sentence.
I came
across. No, what would obtain now here onward is the caste in different colors, right? The classical caste no more remain, you know. As I said variously, that caste and class got intermingled. so what now, supposing now the kind of thing that they want to bring in is very much secular way. There is nothing like Brahmin, Shudra, Vaishya and all that kind of stuff. but they could be quite secular, but still there would be kind of hierarchy, that in that hierarchical way they conceive that the ideal system could be there, right? As regard untouchability, unless caste go, untouchability also cannot go. That's actually integral with it. And we know, surveys after survey, in this century, 21st century, there have been 3 surveys and they testify that untouchability is intact. Okay, untouchability is not only to be identified as touch me notism, but untouchability as a discrimination, untouchability as a barriers, etc., etc., is still intact. Okay, so and your allusion to something like corporate development and things like, which many people imagine that when the globalization or neoliberalism, etc., came, that time many Dalits came forward. You know, that entire Dalit capitalism paradigm actually was created alongside that neoliberalism is very good for Dalits. That would demolish caste, etc., etc. Now, anyway, it's an empirical reality. There is nothing much to discuss. Theoretically, there was nothing to say such kind of thing. But even empirical reality disproves it, right?
Thank you so much for that. We're running out of time. We could have continued, I think. But thank you for being a wonderful audience. Thank you for Professor Teltumde for
thank you.
Very
thank
insightful
you for intelligent
conversation. Thank you.